Good morning and welcome to New Hope Community Church. It is great to see you out today. A little surprise in the weather, huh? Man, when I got here at 5 o'clock this morning, it was hot, and I came back out at 6:30 and it was cooler. I said, wow, I could have worn a suit today. Not really. Anyway, I hope you recognize there's a question on the shirt, all right? And it says, ask me what I believe. And you can see some new posters up here, all right? Have a seat, that front row right here. Good, come right on up. Good to see you. Hey, you're pregnant. Just thought, in case you didn't know, thought I'd tell you. I already knew that. It wasn't risky, okay? It wasn't risky. I already knew that. But anyway, as you know, we're going to be starting a new series called Believe in just a couple of weeks. And this is the sequel to the story that we did a little over 2 years ago. We talked about upper story and lower story perspectives. And now we're going to talk about how what we believe impacts the way in which we live. And we're going to spend 30 weeks, 10 weeks looking at the key doctrines, the key truths of the Bible that impact the key actions of our life, that impact the character development, the 10 fruit of the Spirit, all right, activities of Christ in us that ought to be evident. And it all starts with what we believe. So what do I believe? Come to New Hope Church for the next 32 weeks in a row, and you will find out, all right? And I hope you will come to as many of those next 32 weeks, much like the story. Do your best not to miss. If you do miss, go online and watch what you missed out on, because all of this builds on each other. What we believe is the foundation, and then what grows from that is our actions and our becoming. And so an important time for us. So that's going to kick off in a couple of weeks. Let me highlight, if you are visiting with New Hope, there are some visitor cards in the pew in front of you. Would love for you to take one out, fill it out, drop it in the offering bag, let us know of your presence today and next week through the mail. Not a knock at your door, not pestering you on the phone, but through the mail, send you information that tells you about New Hope Church. If there is some room on your pew, kind of scoot towards the center. So we got some folks in the back. There's room. All right, good, good, good. We don't want them to have to stand up through the preaching. They might pass out. Anyway, drop that card in the offering bag, and we will give you information in the mail we hope will be helpful. Couple of events coming up. This Tuesday night, all-church skate night, all right, at Cal Skate Roller Rink. How many of you have not been skating in 10 years or more? Raise your hand. Oh, great. We ought to have some fun, all right? We ought to have some fun. I'd encourage you to come. Bring your small group with you, all right? Make it a night out, and it's just from 6 to 8. $6 get you in and get you skates, all right? I have a question. If you don't skate, is it still $6? It's $1. $1 if you're just going to come hang out. Where else can you get cheap entertainment like that? Huh? Seeing some of us skate, $1. Come and watch us, all right? But it'll be a lot of fun. We'd love for you to sign up just so we can give them a heads up about how many are going to show up from New Hope in case we have a turnout like we did for movie night. All right? We wanted to be prepared for us, so we really don't need your phone numbers, I don't think. Just put a name and how many is going to be coming in your party. That would be great. So that's over at Gettysburg and Peach. Gettysburg and Peach by the, down the road from Costco, okay? All right, thank you. Women's events, tickets still available today, right? After the service out here, that's this coming Saturday. 9:30 at Sierra Vista Mall. You girls are going to see a movie together and have refreshments and give outdoor prizes and things. And so price is $5, so that's why you can bring your best friend. Certainly your best friend is worth $5. And buy them a ticket, take them to the movie, introduce them to the rest of the New Hope Church family. It'll be a great time for you ladies together, okay? Next Sunday, if you are a Sunday school teacher at either this service or the 10:45 service, please do your very best to make it to the teacher training program next Sunday afternoon at 12:15. This is for the Believe series, because the Believe series is like the story. What you are hearing in sermon in big church, they are going to be hearing in lesson in Sunday school. So we are all going to be on the same page all the way from our toddler program all the way through adults, all right? And so if you are a Sunday, and remember, we're a beta church, we're a test church on this. We do not have material yet. It will be arriving before next Sunday. for us to review with you and to give you some training on how to use it, okay? Today is also our Homeless Outreach Sunday. After the 10:45 service, at about 12:15, you can meet over in the Murbach building. If you've never been on a homeless outreach, it takes a couple of hours out of your afternoon. Show up at the Murbach building. They'll show you how to help them prepare lunches that you'll be delivering out there and to take other necessary items out to the homeless. So that's today at 12:15. A week from this Tuesday will be the second Tuesday of the month, and it will be Senior Luncheon Day. You guys do not have a special guest in the month of August. You get me, all right, in the month of August, okay? And we are going to pass out to you and explain to you the Judy card, all right? It's a card we've developed as a result of a member of our congregation who died alone in a hospital. And we do not ever want that to happen again, if at all possible. We can't guarantee it, but we're at least going to take steps to try to improve our communication with you and your communication back with us. And while we're doing that, we're also going to provide a form, and we're going to have you actually fill some things out right there that can help you to have plans already in order so your family doesn't have to make some decisions in crisis. We'll do our best to help answer questions about end-of-life decisions, all right? And options that are available and things that maybe you've never thought about. And so we're going to spend that. I know, how do you promote something like this so it sounds like it'll be a lot of fun to come to? can we give away a door prize? Can we? One free casket, all right, for all who come. I'm sorry. But anyway, come. I think it will be a helpful and a beneficial time, all right, for us to talk about those things, okay? Not only is August the 17th the Sunday that we're launching the Believe series, but that Sunday night we're going to have a church-wide business meeting. And this business meeting is to get really your input to us as staff and board. We talked a little bit about the end of the year and the beginning of this year, building opportunities, and we've made some headway into that and some remodel work around here. And we want to get your input on that. And this primarily, these remodel and new construction is going to significantly impact our adult ministries here, which we have not done much for in many, many years, and our young children's ministry, all right? So it's kind of what we're looking at, and we want to talk to you about some of the ideas. So whether you're a member of the church or whether you're a regular attender of the church or you're brand new and you want to know what's going on, I would love for this many to be at a church business meeting, all right? Usually we have about this many at a church business meeting, all right? So it'd be great to have many of you out for this. There is a men's ministry opportunity. We can help a sister church in southwest Fresno, Mount Olive Missionary Baptist Church, where Pastor Ed Lee has been there for a long, long time. His church got attacked by graffiti artists. I mean, not just minimally, I mean big time. And so we are looking for folks who have painting skills and, more importantly, painting equipment with the skills that know how to use that equipment. And if you would be available on that Saturday, which is September the 6th, correct? See or contact Gene Sperling. And we have a men's breakfast that day, and you could go over as a group and help them wipe out the graffiti there at their church. And we would love to be of help to one of our sister churches. Let me take care of a few prayer requests, and then we'll get engaged in the rest of our worship. Wanda Wood, part of our 8 o'clock service. Wanda Wood had some biopsies done a few weeks ago and received the information this week. She has stage 3 breast cancer. The good news is it's not stage 4. The bad news is it wasn't stage 1 or 2. And so she starts chemotherapy this week. She will go through 18 weeks of chemotherapy. She will have a short period of time for recovery, and then they will do pretty major surgery. All right, so please be praying for Wanda as she goes through this. Joan Den Hartog had cataract surgery this week. She is continuing to improve. Received a prayer request from Marcy Powers here from a friend of hers who's a missionary in the Philippines. Her name is Sherry Bailey, and having some health issues and would like to get back to the field, but is still having these challenges. So please be praying for her health concerns. Frank Kirkman from our church, who was in ICU last week, is improving. He is out of ICU, and he is in a regular room, and that is significant improvement. It's great to see Bernice with us in church today. Last Sunday, she was with her son, and we've been sharing with you for several weeks. He was under hospice care. I've also shared with you that even though he could barely get out of bed on Sunday mornings, he kind of had extra strength and wanted to go to worship and went every Sunday. Up until last Sunday, he was still getting in a wheelchair and going to church because that is where he wanted to be. Last Sunday morning, Bernice leaned over and whispered to him, "Why don't you go to big church today?" And within about an hour, he went to heaven and got to engage in worship in a way like he had never done before. And Sunday services will be tomorrow at 2 o'clock at Clovis Veterans Memorial Building. He had been in the Air Force, and so services will be there. Please be praying for Bernice and also his wife Sharon and the rest of their family. They would appreciate that. The Kishon family, we have a memorial service here on Friday, and the Peabody family will be here on Tuesday. So if you'd remember both of those families, and then Jackie Scott's family, whose service was here this past week, all of them would appreciate that. Let me take care of this now, and I won't do it during the sermon. This is a book that we sold out here during the series we've been on that we had intended to wrap up today, but you know, the Bible says with God all things are possible. They are with him, but they're not with me. And I probably had about a two-hour sermon I thought I could finish in about 35 minutes today, and I found out on the 8 o'clock service I couldn't. So we will be wrapping it up next week instead of this week. But I would encourage you, if you didn't get a copy of this, whether it's at Costco or Majesty or online, pick up a copy of the Daniel Plan, 40 Days to a Healthier You. We have been looking at how our lives can be healthier tomorrow than they are today, next week than they are now, next month, next year. And we've not just been looking at physical health, though that is a part of it, but we have looked at physical and spiritual and emotional and mental and financial in every ways that we can make decisions so that our lives are healthier. And I would heartily recommend that so that you can refer to what's in there again and again and again, because this is not a fad. This is not designed to be something short term. This is designed to be a lifestyle of good, healthy choices for all of us. This body is what God has given to us to function in this world. And how we care for this body will also influence the way in which we function, how long and how well. This body, the Bible says, not this building called New Hope, this body is the temple of the living God. And we ought to take care of it. And so I would encourage you, pick that up somewhere. I do not get a commission off that, but I think it is a very valuable resource to have. Bombardier, what is it like to throw an anchor overboard on your boat? Should I tell them what I heard happened? You didn't have it tied to the boat anywhere? Yeah. Yeah. Your anchor doesn't hold if it's not tied to you, all right? And he's sitting there trying to figure out, how did he find out about that? Nobody in this church told me, Bob. Nobody in this church told me. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward, and we're going to pray. Yeah. I will now have Bob will not sleep during this sermon today. Father, one of the lessons that I think is often difficult for us to learn is that you have made available to us all the resources of the life of Christ for every moment of every day. You have made available to us the peace and the patience and the love and the kindness and the gentleness of Jesus Christ. You've made those available to us 24/7. And Father, unfortunately, we have not made ourselves available to you 24/7. There are times we choose to handle life and we forget that we have your peace and your patience and your gentleness and your kindness and your compassion available to us. And so we deal with life out of our own human personality. And Father, sometimes that works out well for us, but often it doesn't. And so I confess to you today those areas of neglect in my own life where this week I was not as available to you as you have made your Son available to us. And I pray that I will grow in maturity in those areas so that all that Christ is can be seen and evident in all that I am. Father, I love you, and I am so grateful for all that you have done. And Father, I am exceedingly excited to see what you will continue to do through your family called New Hope here in the city of Clovis and Fresno. I trust you with the needs that we've already talked about today. You know intimately more about them than any of us do. And you also know about those needs that are private and personal to all who've gathered here. So thank you that you're big enough for the task of all of them. For the privilege of giving and sharing today, we say thank you. We commit our needs, our gifts, and our lives to you in the name of Christ. Amen and amen. Now that ought to wake you up, I tell you. Until this week, I had never heard that before. I like it. I think you can add that one to my repertoire of memorial service songs, all right? It's just going to be a concert that night, all right? It's just going to be a concert. Wow. Actually, that reminds me, y'all remember the story I've told about the mule that fell into the well? You remember that one? Shake, shake, shake. All right, I won't tell it again today then, since y'all said yeah. All right, turn your Bibles to Psalm 139. Psalm 139. When people are hurting, they need simple truth, not simplistic truth. You see, it's not enough to tell somebody who's hurting, Jesus is the answer. We know that Jesus is the answer, but we need to show how Jesus is the answer. Does that make sense? We've got to give them some foundation of why is it that Jesus is the answer. It's not enough to say, hey, pray, read your Bible, go to church. We've got to help people know how to make changes or how changes come into their life. The Bible says there's nothing simple about you. You are very complex. You are multifaceted. You're not easy to understand and you are not easy to explain. There are many factors and there are many forces that create you. And in Psalm 139, verse 14, David says that we are fearfully and wonderfully made. In another version of that same verse, it says it like this: thank you, Lord, for making me so wonderfully complex. If you circle things in your Bible, circle fearfully and wonderfully. And then if you write in your Bible, write complex. You are fearfully and wonderfully complex. That's who we are. And guys, if you are sitting next to your wife right now, husbands, lean over to your wife and whisper these words: honey, you are wonderfully complex. Some of you men did not do that. Wives, I want you to return the favor. Lean over to your husband, whisper in his ear these words: darling, you are amazingly simple. It would help if you were sitting next to your wife, wouldn't it, John? Don't say that to Bob, all right? Yeah, don't whisper that to Bob. You see, men, we just got on-off switches, man. Women, you got gauges and dials and buttons and procedures, all right? Man, we just on-off, all right? Actually, the Bible says about us men as well, we are wonderfully complex. To become all that God intends us to be, we have to look at all the dimensions of our life, not just one. That is why in this series, as we have been looking at 40 Days to a Healthier You, it's not just been looking at our lives physically or only at our lives spiritually, but looking at this complexity of who we are in every facet of our life. Ecclesiastes 7:18, in the Message paraphrase, it renders Ecclesiastes 7:18 this way: a person who fears and trusts God deals responsibly with all of reality, not just a piece of it. If you and I are going to be who God wants us to be, we're going to have to look at every area of our life, every factor, every facet, every force in life, and we need to deal with all of them in order to be all that God wants to be and accomplish in our lives. Today, what I want us to look at is the subject of being who God meant for us to be. I think that is important as we understand why there is great importance to us being healthy in all areas of our life. I'm kind of putting a name to this sermon called Winning the Hand You're Dealt. Because there are actually five factors in our life, not one, but at least five, that influence our identity and who we are. Do you remember the parable in Matthew chapter 25 of the talents? Jesus said that the master goes out and he gives one guy 10 talents, and he gives another guy 5 talents, and he gives the third guy 1 talent. And then he says, go out and make the most of what I have given to you. You're not going to be responsible for what you weren't given, but you do have a responsibility for what you were given. The guy with 5 talents, he was not responsible for the additional 5 that the guy with 10 had. And the guy who had 1 talent, he wasn't responsible for the other 14, all right, that the 2 other guys had. You're only responsible for what you have been given. You are not going to be evaluated or judged by God for opportunities that we didn't have. But God will one day evaluate our life on what we did with what we were given. And the point of the parable of the talents is we all don't get the same thing. We don't have the same opportunities or talents. We don't have the same background, the same pain, the same problem, or the same potential. We don't have the same anything except for this one fact. All of us are loved by God. The one with 10, the one with 5, the one with the 1, all loved by the Master. We are all unique and we are all different. But there are 5 factors that create our identity. We didn't choose these factors. God dealt them to us. And just as you didn't choose your talents, and you didn't choose the talents that you don't have, you didn't choose a lot of other things in your life that make you you and me me. So I want us to look at that today. I happened to find a deck of cards here at the church. In fact, on the box of the cards, it says New Hope. I'm not sure I've ever found a deck of cards with a church name on it before, but it's quite interesting. But I want us to look at the hand we've been dealt. How many of you have ever played poker before? Would you raise your hand? You've played poker before. Good. A lot of sinners here today. Actually, I'm just kidding on that part, all right? Actually, I'm not, but not because of the cards, all right? But I'm feeling more comfortable knowing that you've played poker, so this analogy, this metaphor may make sense in your mind. I hope it does. In 5-card stud, how many cards do you get? 5. Yeah, good, all right. All right, you could have even figured that one out if I'm just taking the top 5 off the deck. Pardon me? No, but close, okay? Anyway, I'm just pulling 5 cards right off the top of the deck. And 5-card stud, different than 5-card draw, you have to play the 5 cards you're dealt, okay? You don't get to turn any back and hope to get some new ones. You don't get to swap with anybody else at the table. You can't really say, I don't want these cards. They're the cards you get. 1 down, 3 up, 1 down, all right? Right? I had to go read about that game before this morning. I didn't know anything about it. But you can only play the cards you're dealt. And in many ways, this is a metaphor in life. There are some things that you've been dealt in life you didn't choose. You didn't choose your parents. You didn't choose when you were born. You didn't choose where you were born or how you were born. You know, C-section, natural birth. You didn't choose your race. You didn't choose your talents. You didn't choose the talents you don't have. There are a lot of things that make you, you, and me, me, that we had no choice in all. They are the hand you were dealt, but you've got to play the cards that you were dealt. Here's the cards I was dealt today. All right, just purely off the top of the deck. Ace of diamonds. Ace of spades. This is looking like a good hand. Would you look at that? Ace of hearts. Oh, my goodness. What else went there? Oh, ace of clubs. All right, let me turn them this way. Can you all still see those underneath the... There we go. I didn't rehearse this in advance. And then the 5th card, I got a wild card. Got the joker. Wow. Wouldn't that be a great hand to be dealt in life? Doesn't usually work out that way, but we're going to talk about it. Now, the Bible tells us a lot about the 5 factors that we're given in life that make us us. But before I get to those 5 factors... The Bible tells us 4 facts about those 5 factors. So let's hit those four things real quick. The first thing about these five factors of life, each of these cards represents something that makes you you and me me. It's that every one of these cards is flawed. There's a bend in this card. There's a crease in this card. Somebody's been cheating with this deck. There's a scratch off this one. They're not perfect cards. It's not a brand new deck. Just as these cards aren't perfect, your life and my life's not perfect either. We have been marred by sin. Every one of these cards is imperfect because nothing is perfect on this planet. The Bible says nothing is perfect except for God's Word. Everything in the world is broken. Our weather is broken. We are dry and hot, and in the Midwest, they're cold and wet. All right? It ought not to be that way right now. This thing ought to even out, but it's not fair. It's broken. There's tornadoes, and there's earthquakes, and there's typhoons. God didn't plan for the earth to be that way. God planned a perfect world, but it has been broken by sin. We know that our economy is broken. Right? Anybody think we've got a perfect, healthy economy? Okay. It doesn't work perfectly. We know that our body does not work perfectly. Anybody got some complaints about your body today? If you don't, I have a few about yours, all right? Things don't work the right way as we think they ought to. Our bodies are broken. Nobody has a perfect body except for me. I have Shelly. Oh, didn't I do good on that one? All right. I'm making up for last week. You see, we know that no relationship is perfect. The two imperfect people cannot create a perfect relationship. You can't have two imperfect people and expect perfection. Nothing in our life will ever be perfect. If you expect perfection on earth, you're expecting heaven on earth. Let me tell you where I run into this more often than not. Brides. They want the perfect wedding. I try to pop that bubble the very first appointment I have with them. I tell them it's just not going to be perfect, and if you get that in your head that it's not going to be, you'll enjoy the event a whole lot more. Because it just won't be, because there's too many imperfect people involved in it. This is not heaven. This is earth. Nothing works correctly here. Everything works correctly in heaven. In heaven, there's no sorrow, no sadness, no tears, no trials, no trouble, no pain, no pressure, no conflict. But this on earth is not heaven. We are to pray according to Jesus' model, "Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven," because it's done perfectly there but not here. This is not heaven. So why are we reluctant to go to heaven? Why do we tend to want, let's not be in a hurry. Don't misunderstand me. I don't want to go before my appointed time, but I ought to be thrilled when my appointment time comes, because things are perfect there. Everything in our life, all the factors we've been dealt, all the cards we've been dealt, have imperfections, marred by sin. That's the first thing we need to know. The second thing we need to know about these five cards is that God sent Jesus as our Savior to not only save us from all of our sin, not only to save us into heaven, not only to save us out of hell, but to save us from ourselves while here on earth. He sent Jesus to transform the cards we've been given, to change the deck, to turn it into a winning hand. That's what it means to have Jesus as our Savior. We're going to talk about that today. The third thing that the Bible teaches is that one day we will give an account to God on how we played our hand. I've told you I don't fully understand how this accountability thing goes, but there are several passages in the Bible that says one day God will separate the sheep from the goats. One day the sheep will give an account of how they lived their lives. What was done in the flesh, what was done by the Spirit. We will give an account. We will not give an account for why we didn't handle our life like our brother or our sister, like our mom and our dad or our best friend, because we don't have the same hand. We weren't dealt the same cards. But God does have some expectations about how we'll play the hand that we've been dealt, just as Jesus told the parable of the talents. But the good news, the fourth thing, and what we'll be looking at today is that the Bible tells us how to still win the game with the hand we've been dealt. And I'm going to be using this metaphor to talk about the five things that influence our life that make us us. And then what God says to do with them to make sure that this is a winning hand. This is the only game of cards I know of where every hand can win. Every hand can win. If you want to understand who you really are, you have to understand these five factors that make you you and me me. Number one, the first factor that makes you you is what I call our chemistry. Chemistry. This is the chromosomes, the DNA, the genes, the hormones. It's your chemical makeup. At the most basic biological level, it's you and it's your body. Everything that happens to you in life happens in your body, and our bodies are made of chemicals. Some of you were born, for instance, with hypersensitivity to pain. You notice pain very, very easily. You are the princess and the pea. You remember that story? If you don't, I don't have time to tell it to you today. But if something, Google princess and the pea, and you will find it very quickly, all right? If something doesn't fit right or feel right, you notice immediately. And that's not right or wrong. It's the way you're wired. It's your chemistry. Others of you, you were born with a very high tolerance for pain. You can say, just give me the stitches, all right? Forget the pain medication. Just sew me up. That's not better or worse. It is just different. Others of you were born with low energy. That's not right or wrong. Some of us just are a little bit low on energy. I could use some of yours. Others of us are born with high energy, all right? We're just the ever-ready bunny rabbit, all right? Again, one is not better or worse. It's just different. Some of us, some people can eat, not us. Some people could just eat and eat and eat, never put a pound on. Other people just look at a box of chocolates, okay? And swelling starts. It just happens. Well, one's not better, one's not worse. It's just different. It is our chemistry. All of these have biological and chemical challenges. These create emotional problems. They create physical problems. They create mental problems in our lives. If you have low thyroid, you can exercise all you want to and you're still not going to have enough energy because your thyroid is low. You need to get thyroid supplements. It's a physical chemical reaction. If you have calcium deficiency in your body, you are probably going to have brittle bones. I don't care how positively you think with your mind, if you don't have calcium in your bones, they're going to get brittle and fragile. If you were low on hormones, I probably shouldn't go there. Estrogen or testosterone, or you have an iron deficiency of another chemical, it's going to affect you emotionally and mentally as well as physically. One chemical I've just come across in preparation for today, and I've learned something very interesting, and I had to verify I was pronouncing the term correctly in the last service. There is this chemical called oxytocin. Do not confuse this with oxycontin, all right? Two different things, all right? This is a natural chemical in our body called oxytocin. And this is the chemical inside of us that creates connection in relationships. It's the chemical that bonds us to each other in relationship. It's the relationship chemical. If you are low on oxytocin, what did I just say? Oxytocin, yeah. You have a difficult time connecting with others and pronouncing words correctly. Apparently, it's been proven over and over. They did a study. You can Google this, all right? There's an animal called the prairie vole, not mole. V-O-L-E, the prairie vole. These are little hamsters in the Midwest. Did you have those in Montana, Jerry? All right, it's probably more like Oklahoma and Kansas, all right? All right, prairie voles. You probably had the mountain vole. Yeah, I think you guys had mountain voles in Montana, but yeah. but anyway, this study on prairie voles, these little hamsters, they discovered that they're one of the few animals that actually mate for life besides human beings. They're monogamous. In fact, if the mate dies, they will not find another mate. At least they know that to be true 100% of the time in the males. Females might be slightly more promiscuous, all right? But the males are pretty much right. It's very unusual among these animals, all right? They often will stay monogamous. So they studied the prairie voles and discovered what's different about them than all other mammals is they have an extremely high level of oxytocin in them. That is what connects them to each other. When they lowered the oxytocin in the prairie vole, They became as frisky as rabbits. It was a chemical thing for them, oxytocin. It's released in a mom when she's nursing a baby. When a mom holds a baby to her breast, it releases oxytocin in her brain, not only in the baby, but in the mom. And this is the bonding chemical that bonds a mother and a baby. It's amazing how God has created our bodies. When a husband and a wife make love, when they have sex, it releases oxytocin in both the husband and the wife. This is not a chemical more present in one than the other. It's present in both of us. But it produces incredible rates at the time of intimacy, and it bonds husbands and wives emotionally together. Guys, that was God's idea when He created us. Oxytocin was what He put in us chemically. It's one of the reasons that sexless marriages often grow cold. They aren't as close because they're missing this chemical component that God gave to us that bonds us together. It's the reason God says also, folks, those of you who are single, don't have sex outside of marriage. Because not only are you experiencing a physical sexual release, but you are also releasing oxytocin. It's what bonds you together. You do it outside of marriage. It's why often there is such emotional pain and rejection, because this has been produced in you. That's why God says, wait till marriage. They've even discovered that 20 minutes of petting a dog releases oxytocin to both the owner and the dog. And that's probably why it said that dog is man's best friend. Yeah. Notice it never says that about cats. If you don't have oxytocin in quantity in your body, you're going to have a difficult time connecting and bonding with people. You will have a more difficult time trusting others. It's simply part of the chemistry. It is the way that we are wired. Write this down if you're taking notes. And quite frankly, write this down even if you're not taking notes. This is important. No flaw is sinful or shameful. No flaw is sinful or shameful. In my physical body, in my biology, in my chemistry, these flaws are not shameful or sinful. It's how we're wired. The last taboo in this particular card is mental illness. And people don't like to talk about mental illness. It's like it's the bad, keep it in the closet thing. Mental illness is no different than physical illness or emotional illness. It has a chemical basis. Mental illness is no more to be ashamed of than cancer. It is no more to be ashamed of than if you have a degenerated disc in your back. It's just part of who you are. Everything in our lives is broken, and there's chemistry behind most of it. Our genes have flaws that makes us unique. We're not a carbon copy or a clone or mass-produced anything. Flaws often create uniqueness. Our genes have intentional flaws to create. Our flaws are a custom design by our Creator God and by our original father, Adam. All right? So there are flaws that we have. Paul said it this way, I have a thorn in my flesh. Paul said, I have a thorn in my flesh. And most people think it's one of two things. He either had bad eyesight. There are some who have said that Paul might have had to deal with depression, mental illness. Here's what I do know in the book of Galatians, chapter 4, verse 13, as he writes to the church in Galatia, in Greece. He says, you remember that it was because of my illness that I came to you the first time preaching the good news. I had to stop in your town because of my illness. God took the flaw and He used it for good. The first characteristic in our life that makes us us is our biology, our chemistry. Number two, second card. Okay, second card. You see why I'm not going to finish this today? The second thing that determines our identity is connections, my connections. My chemistry and my connections. Those are my relationships. We are a product of our relationship, especially those early years of our life. Those relationships may have been good, they may have been bad, they may have been healthy, they may have been unhealthy, they may have been non-existent, they may have been abusive, but we are a product of our relationships, particularly in those early years. Study after study shows that our identity, how we see ourselves, is largely determined by what the important people in our life thought about us and what they said to us. What we think the most important people think about us often determines our image, our esteem, and our self-concept. That's why I have said time and time again, make sure the most important person in your life is Jesus Christ, because He is going to love us unconditionally, and He's going to tell us the truth. So the connections in our life, our relationships, help determine our identity. These connections give our life meaning. They give our life purpose. They give our life identity. If we grew up feeling disconnected from others, we might have a harder time knowing what the meaning of our life is. We have a hard time figuring out what purpose does my life live for. We have a hard time with understanding our identity. People who have healthy connections in life rarely look in the mirror and say, "Does my life matter? Does my life count? Is my life going to make a difference?" But if we feel dysfunction in our relationships, it will affect all these areas. It affects the meaning and the purpose that we have of life. Why? Because life is all about relationships. I do not say this in any sense of pride or bragging, but out of deep gratitude. I was blessed in my life to have godly parents and grandparents. I was blessed in my life to have grandparents and parents who wanted a relationship with their son, their daughter, and their grandkids. I was blessed in my life to have these six people pour into my life individually and collectively. The idea, Tim, God wants to work in your life. Tim, God has great plans in your life. I grew up hearing that from the time I was a small child. My parents had people into our home on a regular basis, men like Malcolm Fry, who preached my ordination. Malcolm shared my bedroom when I was 12, 13, 14 years of age, and he was a Bible conference speaker in our church for 4 or 5 years in a row. Malcolm Fry, at the end of the evening, would sit on the edge of the twin bed in the room that he shared with me when he was our guest. And he would say, "Tim, I think God has a plan for you." And he would give me a verse. And the next time he would come, he said, "You remember that verse I gave you last year?" "Yes." And he would give me another verse. And he said, "Make these the foundation of your life." And long before I was qualified or able, people that God had placed in my life because of my parents gave me opportunities to try things I should have never been able to try. I'm blessed because of that. But I also understand there are other families, circumstances, And guys, I had nothing to do with that. I had no control over the people who poured goodness into my life. Shelley didn't have that same kind of background. There wasn't that much goodness thrown in, and there certainly was some harm. Yours is going to be different. But those early relationships often make a difference in our life, and it's why it's important. I challenge you as grandparents, pour the love of God from your life into your grandkids' life. Pour all that God can bring to your attention. Tell your grandkids and your kids, God has plans and purposes for you. One day Jesus was walking down the street and a guy came up to him and said, "Hey, well, what's life all about?" And Jesus said back to him, "Life's about love. It's not about accomplishment or acquisition, popularity or power or prestige. It's about love. It's about relationships." In fact, Jesus said to him, you can summarize this in a short sentence. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Because Jesus made this simple. He said, "Moses gave you 10 commandments. I'm going to give you one sentence. Because if you remember the one sentence, you will keep the 10 commandments." It's so easy. It's so easy. Love, relationship with God, relationship with those around you. Make the connection with God, make the connection with others. He said, if you don't have that, you miss the purpose of life. It is about love and relationship. The second factor in my life, this card called connections. There are three problems with this card. One, I already mentioned it. We are imperfect. And since we're imperfect, so will our relationships. And that causes problems and misunderstandings and conflicts. And that's magnified when all you do is text to each other. So talk to each other. Second of all, sin disconnects us. Sin disconnects us from God. All have sinned and we fall short of God's glory. We are separated from Him. It disconnects us from each other because as we saw in the first couple, Adam and Eve, they had a perfect relationship in a perfect environment. They were in love. They had no conflict. There was no disharmony amongst them. Everything going great. God says, "This whole garden is yours. Everything is yours to share. Hundreds, thousands of options. There's just one thing, don't touch." He just put wet paint on one tree. And guess where Adam and Eve ran? to the one tree. God didn't give them 10 things not to do or 100. He gave them one. Why? Because, folks, love is a choice. If I can't choose not to love you, love is not a choice. And God gave them the opportunity. You can eat of the tree and choose not to love me. You can do anything you want. Why did they do that? They headed for the one thing they weren't supposed to. And after they sinned, Adam takes it like a man. He blames his wife. God says, Adam, what'd you do? He says, Lord, the woman you gave me, she gave me this fruit. Notice he's not only blaming Eve, Adam is blaming God. God, the woman you gave me. If you hadn't brought this female into my life, things would be copacetic. Things would be just fine. God, it's your fault. He starts blaming, and we've been doing that ever since, haven't we? Accusing and excusing. Accusing and excusing. We accuse others, and we excuse ourselves. We hide our faults. We hurl at others, and we've been doing it ever since. And that affects our connections. Once they sin, they not only feel disconnected from God, but Adam and Eve suddenly feel disconnected from each other. What does it say? What did Adam and Eve do after they sinned? They what? They hid, but what did they do for each other? They put clothes on. They put clothes on. They've been running around naked for weeks, months, or years. I don't know how long that period of time was before they ate, but they've been running around naked. There was no problem. No problem. And all of a sudden, God hadn't come down to walk with them in the cool of the evening yet, but all of a sudden they looked at each other and they said, uh-oh, we better cover up. And we've been attempting to cover up ever since. We fake it. We cover up. We don't expose our vulnerabilities, our defects, and our faults. And that's what sin does. Men and women and people have been covering up physically and emotionally and mentally. That connection card has caused all kinds of damage in our life because nobody's perfect and sin disconnects us. But here's a third problem with this card. The more disconnected I am, the more fearful I become. Fear comes from disconnection. When I feel disconnected from God, I fear God. And so when I fear something, what do? We avoid Him. We stay away. When I feel disconnected from you, I fear you and I don't want to run into you. When I feel disconnected at a party, I fear everybody at the party. Disconnection causes fear. If we grow up feeling disconnected, we have a hard time trusting other people. It's part of the way our identity has been formed. What happens is we get caught in this dilemma, and it's a terrible dilemma because we crave connection. We deeply crave it, but we fear making connections. We crave intimacy. We want it, but we fear vulnerability, which is the only way to get it. We want one without the other, and it doesn't happen. And I'm not just talking about sexual intimacy. I'm talking about in every area of our life, that deep soul searching, that heart-to-heart connection. I'm totally understood, and I totally understand you. We accept each other. We love each other. We crave it, but we fear the vulnerability. We crave acceptance, but we fear rejection, and that forms our identity. There's a third card that makes you you and me me. My chemistry, that's my biology, my body. My connections, that's my relationships. The third card that makes you you and me me is my circumstances. My circumstances in life. Those are things that happened to you. None of these were in your control. You didn't choose your chemistry. You didn't choose your connections. And certainly when you're young, you haven't chosen all the circumstances. The things that happened to you and the things that happened around you help shape your identity. We are a product of the traumas and the troubles and the triumphs in our life. We are the product of suffering and shame and shock and stress and success. Problems shape our life. Pressures shape our life. Pain shapes our life. If you've ever been abused mentally, physically, sexually, I'm sorry. I'm deeply sorry. But you and I both know that that abuse has affected your identity. In whatever shape or form or fashion it came, it affected you. And I am sorry. If you have ever experienced rejection in your life, that has impacted you. If you've ever had failure or a series of failure, major failures in your life, that affects your identity. And if we're not careful, we start telling ourselves over and over again, you're a failure, you're a failure, you're damaged, you're damaged.
Even when you've had, even when you have been blessed with a family like I described a few minutes ago, the evil one can take the failures of your life and he can play mind games with you. I have to be careful of myself in this arena. I've made it a practice ever since, as a pastor, I went through a divorce. I've made it a practice every time I sit down with a couple who wants to get married to tell them, in case they would like to find another member of our staff to marry them, I let them know. And I have noticed there are times that the evil one allows those moments to become moments of great discouragement for me. Because for one reason or another, the way my mind thinks, I have chosen to explain it to them. I need you to know at the outset, I am a damaged pastor. And the evil one can take one little word, like damaged. And if I'm not very careful, if I'm not very careful at that moment, then it begins to impact the way in which preparation for next Sunday's sermon goes, because the evil one begins to say, you know, you said it right, you're damaged. What makes you think you have the right to stand up and preach God's truth to anybody? Because we live in a world that can take the negative and use it to shape who we are, rather than to take the truth to shape who we are. Circumstances. It's how we've been dealt with situations in life. There's a fourth card, a fourth factor that makes you, you, and me, me, and this is a big one. It's what I call my consciousness. My consciousness is how I talk to myself. That's your consciousness. How you talk to yourself. How you think about you. Some of you are sitting there and saying, oh, Tim, I don't talk to myself. Yes, you do. In fact, you're doing it right now. Right now, what you were saying is he going to finish anywhere close to on time today? I know you're saying that. And some of you were saying, how did Tim find out that Bob lost his anchor? Okay? Yeah. Well, you just have to wait and hang around. If you talk, if we were to talk to our friends the way we talk to ourselves, we wouldn't have very many friends. Because we are our toughest critic. And by the way, we lie to ourselves all the time. The Bible says the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked. We lie to ourselves more than we lie to anybody else. We tell ourselves things that aren't true, and then we actually believe them after we told them to ourselves long enough. Our consciousness influences our identity. What I say to myself, not what other people said to me, even though they might have said, you are no good, you are worthless, you are shameful, you'll never amount to anything, you're uncoordinated, you aren't very attractive, you're a loser, blah, 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 blah. We file that away. But that's not what does the damage. What does the damage is when we pull that file out and we start repeating what's in that file. We start saying it to ourselves again. I'm never going to amount to anything. I'm always going to fail. I am a loser. And it gets deeper and deeper in our consciousness. Our habitual thoughts are our identity. What we think about us. When I begin to think I have been damaged by choices in my life, I have to remember that God says, you were a new creation. Old things have passed away and all things become new. I have to remember that God says, you are no longer a child of Satan. You are now a child of God. I have to remember that God says you are now a saint, saved by the incredible life of Jesus Christ through grace by faith in Him. I have to remember those things. Otherwise, I will believe the lie that my mind says to my heart. Proverbs 23:7 says, for as a man thinks, where? In his heart, so is he. What you think about you, that's you, whether it's true or not. Proverbs 4:23 says, be careful what you think, because your thoughts run your life. If you want your life to go in a different direction, you've got to redirect your thoughts. Here's the amazing thing. When you think a thought, it doesn't have to be true to hurt you. You just have to believe it. So if somebody says you're never going to amount to anything and you believe it, guess what? You probably will not amount to anything. If you tell yourself this marriage isn't going to last, guess what? It probably won't. The person who says, I can't, and the person who says, I can, they are both right. For as a man thinketh, so is he. Be careful what you think, because your thoughts run your life. And if you think a thought long enough, you will become it. And if you believe it about yourself, you will act it out. Here's the problem. You know those fears that you've got that you keep going over and over in your mind? Our fears are often self-fulfilling. We sabotage our own lives. Job 3:25, and you know what happened to Job, right? In Job 3:25, Job says, "What I have always feared has happened to me. What I dreaded has come to pass." Self-fulfilling prophecy. That's the problem with fear. Fears become reality. We start acting in the way that we are fearful. I'm afraid to do this. So when we are afraid to do this, we don't do it. I'm afraid I can't do this, and then we can't do it. You say, "There's nothing I can do to change. That's just a phobia I have." Are you sure? Are you sure? I suggest you have to challenge your thoughts. Challenge the misconceptions constantly, or they're going to dominate your life and send you in the wrong direction. You tell yourself all the time, "I can never change." But are you sure? Write this down. This is another good line right here. Three words. Feelings aren't facts. Feelings aren't facts. I feel unattractive. That doesn't mean you are. I feel fat. Doesn't mean you are. Do you know the people I know who think they are the fattest are what? They're the skinniest. They're going on feelings. I feel nobody would ever want to marry me. And with attitude, you're probably correct. But feelings aren't facts. They're feelings, and feelings lie all the time. So my consciousness affects my identity. But here's the fifth card. The fifth card that makes me, me, and you, you is our choices. The Bible says that we were created in the image of God. Okay, no other animals are created in the image of God. Cows aren't created in God's image. Rabbits aren't created in the image of God. Monkeys aren't created in the image of God. Dogs are not created in the image of God. I am sorry, but cats are not created in the image of God. All right, but what does all this mean when it says "I am"? It means a lot of things, but one of them is this. We have a free moral choice. Dogs do not make moral decisions. They have instincts, but they don't know the difference between right and wrong. Cats and elephants make moral choices. But elephants don't have ethics, and cats don't have morality, all right? We got a cat. His name is Herndon, okay? Herndon's not on my good list this week, all right? Back at the vet this week again, all right? I spent more money on one cat than all the dogs I've ever owned in my life. I think they should only have one life, then it wouldn't cost us so much, okay? Here's the deal. Cats like to scratch things. They like to scratch your furniture, right? They like to sharpen their nails. You know what? We've tried to teach Herndon not to do that. Herndon knows he can't get on a kitchen counter in our house. He doesn't do it, all right? He just doesn't. He's been taught. He's learned how to do it. Learned how not to do it, all right? But you know what? He does not do it because he thinks that's morally right. He doesn't scratch the furniture because he thinks that's the morally correct decision to make. He doesn't jump on the kitchen counter, and he doesn't scratch the furniture because he gets in trouble if he does. And I promise you this. If in 3 weeks we did not stay on him to not do that behavior, guess what he would resort to doing? He would start scratching furniture and jumping on counters. Why? Because to the cat, it is not right or wrong. It's what a cat does. We don't get that same excuse in life. We have moral choice. You and I can't say, "I sin because I'm a sinner." No, we have the moral choice to make a difference between right and wrong. The freedom of choice is our greatest blessing and our greatest curse. We make dumb decisions all the time. We make self-defeating choices. We make harmful choices that harm ourselves, our bodies, our circumstances, and those around us. So it becomes a negative thing in our life, but also can become a blessing. That's the good news about this last card. This is the one we do have something about. The other four were primarily out of our hands. This one is ours to choose. This wild card can change the impact of the entire hand you're holding. Your choice determines the other cards. Ultimately, our identity is based on our choices, and this wild card is so important. This is where I've got to wrap it up today. I intended to talk about 5 winning choices that you can make with this wild card. But we will look at those 5 winning choices next week, okay? But here's the deal. I had intended to give you an opportunity to make a choice today. And if you're here and something has resonated with you about your past and the things that you did not have control over that maybe has shaped your attitude, has influenced you in the wrong direction, you don't have to wait till next Sunday to make a choice. Jesus Christ came to make a difference in your life. He came to transform us from all of the junk that those other factors in your life have created for you. He took a thief on a cross and made him a saint just like this. He took a woman at a well and he turned into an evangelist just like this. He took a woman sick with issues of blood and he brought her to her feet just like that. And Jesus can take you today, and in spite of the influences in your past that have been bad and ugly and negative, God says, I can take the old and I can make it new. All you have to do is say, God, I want you to make the difference in the hand that's been dealt to my life. Let's pray. Dear Father, there are influences in our life that were outside of our control. We understand, I hope, maybe a bit more about some of them. Chemistry, circumstances, conditions. But Father, you've given to us Christ. You can be the wild card that takes a losing hand and transforms it into a winning one. That this is the only game I know of poker where everybody can win. Everybody can walk out with the royal flush when we let Christ be our king. So Lord, for that man or woman who's been beaten down by what others have said and what others have done, may they see your hand reaching to them saying, come with me. I've got a new direction that will be filled with meaning and purpose in your life. Thank you that you hear their heart's cry. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.